Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. In this video, we will learn about the tech dehydration process. Before we start, let me just give you a brief introduction about the tech dehydration plants. The TEG plants are particularly used in the upstream operations when you are extracting the oil and gas from the reservoir. So when we extract the natural gas from the reservoir, it is found to be saturated with water. The presence of water in natural gas can create multiple problems, such as it can reduce the pipeline capacity, it can cause slugging, hydrate formations, and increase corrosion. So therefore, in order to make the gas safe for transport over the pipelines and to protect your rotary equipment, such as your compressors, we need to dehydrate the gas, or in other words, we need to depress the dew point of the gas. For that, we have this process known as tech dehydration process, which uses triethylene glycol. So what the triethylene glycol does is that it will absorb all the water vapor that is associated with the wet gas entering the system. So the plant that is illustrated here has an operating capacity of 400 million standard cubic feet, and it is designed to produce a lean dry gas with a maximum water content of 2 pounds per million standard cubic feet. Actually, the plant that is used here is used to treat the lean wet sweet gas that is coming from the lean acid gas recovery unit. That is, the gas that is coming from the absorber top is found to be containing water, that is, it is saturated with water. And this lean wet gas from the absorber needs to be dehydrated so that it can be sent to the NGL recovery unit for NGL recovery. Alright, so in other words, this is nothing but lean tech dehydration process. But of course, the process remains the same. So if you can understand this process, you can very well go and operate the TEG plants in the upstream facilities as well. So, alright, so let's move into the process flow diagram. Right, so this is the overall view of the TEG process. The TEG process basically consists of two sections. The one is the dehydration section and the other is the regeneration section. The dehydration section consists of a high pressure absorber, which is basically a packed section. In some plants, they also use tray columns depending upon the requirements. And the regeneration section consists of the following equipment, of which the main equipments are the glycol reboiler, the glycol still, and the glycol still condenser. Also, we have a glycol stripper, lean rich glycol exchanger, rich glycol flash drum, and the glycol surge drum. In the dehydration section, the process takes place at high pressure and low temperature, whereas in the case of the regeneration section, the process takes place at high temperature and low pressure. So before we move into the details, let me show you how we can determine the amount of water that is entering your TEG unit. For that, we make use of this following chart, which is called the water content of the hydrocarbon gas. This chart is taken from the GPSA engineering data book, and let me show you how I read this thing. These lines that you see are called the pressure lines, that is the pressure of the gas at which it enters your TEG unit. And on the x-axis we have the temperature of the gas entering, and on the y-axis we have the water content of the gas, that is the water content of the wet saturated gas that is entering your system, and this will be in terms of pounds per million standard cubic feet. Alright, so as seen from the chart, they have selected the inlet pressure of the gas at 3000 psi, and it is entering at a temperature of at around 140 degree Fahrenheit. So what they do is just draw a vertical line and intercept that pressure line, and from there draw a horizontal line, and that will give you the corresponding value of the amount of water present in the saturated gas. Here we see it is about 100 pounds per million standard cubic feet. So in the tech dehydration unit, they will dehydrate the gas from 100 pounds per standard cubic feet up to say 10 pounds per standard cubic feet. Well, in this particular plant, the plant is designed to dehydrate the gas from 200 pounds per standard cubic feet up to 2 pounds per million standard cubic feet, because the gas which is coming from the absorber needs to be dehydrated so that it can be used to, so that it is used to recover NGL in the NGL recovery unit. All right, so let us move into the process flow diagram. So this is the inlet. The gas first enters the inlet feed gas filter collector, and it enters at a pressure of about 59 bar and 59 degrees Celsius. So the purpose of the inlet feed gas filter collector is that it helps to capture any free water that enters along the feed, and also it helps to capture any liquids, condensed liquids and hydrocarbons that may actually enter your TEG unit, and also the pipeline scaling particles which may enter the system and contaminate your glycol. So in case if any free water enters your TEG unit, it will increase the reboiler load in your regeneration section. And if any hydrocarbons enter your TEG contactor, it will cause severe foaming problems in the TEG contactor, which will result in increased glycol losses and reduced performance. And if there are pipeline scaling particles which come along with the feed, that will contaminate your glycol and it will affect its properties. All right. So once after passing through the inlet feed gas filter collector, the gas will be introduced to the bottom of the glycol contactor. So in that way, the inlet feed gas filter collector will avoid most of the operation problems. All right. So the gas will be introduced to the base of the contactor tower, and the lean glycol, which is your TEG, will enter the top of the packing section at a temperature of 66 degrees Celsius and a pressure at the same pressure, that is 59 bar. And both these streams will contact each other countercurrently, and an intimate contact takes place over the structured packing, and the lean glycol literally absorbs all the water vapor that is associated with the wet gas, and it dries up the gas. And after absorbing the water, the purity of the lean glycol will fall down from 99.9 weight percentage, and it will turn into rich glycol and has a concentration of 94 to 95 percentage by weight. And that rich glycol at the bottom of the lean TEG, at the bottom of the TEG contactor, will be sent to the regeneration section to improve the purity back to 99.9 percentage by weight, so that it can be recirculated into the TEG contactor in order to maintain the dry gas specification. Alright, and the gas after drying up will move up through the demister in order to prevent any entrainment losses of glycol in the overhead. And then the gas will then exchange heat with the hot lean glycol, which is coming from the surge drum at a temperature of 102 degrees Celsius. So that in that way, it will cool down the hot lean TEG from 102 degrees Celsius to 66 degrees Celsius. And the dry gas will then enter an outlet feed gas filter collector. So the purpose of the outlet feed gas filter collector is that just in case if there's any upset, that will result in glycol entrainment losses. And in that feed gas filter collector, it will capture the glycol entrainment and will help to recover it back to the system, and it will be sent to, along with the rich glycol, to the regeneration section. So it helps to prevent any losses incurred. It helps to prevent any entrainment glycol losses due to any upset. And it also helps to protect the downstream equipment with the glycol carryover. And the dry gas will leave the outlet filter at a pressure of 58 bar and 65 degrees Celsius. Alright, then let's move into the regeneration section. The regeneration section consists of the main components, which is the glycol repolar, the glycol still, and the glycol still condenser. Actually, it looks like a single piece of equipment, but actually there are three different pieces of equipment which are integrated to each other. So the glycol repolar top is integrated to a glycol still, which is basically a stripper with the two sections, two packed sections of random packing material, and the top of the glycol still is integrated to a reflux condenser. What we do is the rich glycol at the bottom of the glycol contactor will have a temperature of about 60 degrees Celsius and 59 bar. So that rich glycol will be used as a cooling medium in the reflux condenser in order to cool the hot vapors which are rising up the glycol still. And it will exchange the heat with the hot rising vapors and gets heated up to 73 degrees Celsius. And from there, the rich glycol will be routed to the glycol flash drum. So the pressure here is around 59 bar, but there is a control valve at the downstream of the TEG contactor, and that will reduce the pressure from 59 bar to 6 bar. And therefore, this line will have two-phase flow containing a rich glycol and some hydrocarbons in vapor phase. Of course, rich glycol is more and hydrocarbons is only a small amount. And this stream is used as cooling medium in the reflux condenser to cool the hot vapors which is rising up the glycol still. Alright, and then it will enter the rich glycol flash drum. What happens in the rich glycol flash drum is that the rich glycol along with dissolved hydrocarbons will be flashed inside the flash drum, and the dissolved hydrocarbons will be released, and that will be sent to the fuel gas collection header. If there is any liquid hydrocarbons which settles down in the flash drum, that will be removed through a hydrocarbon collection bucket. Actually, the rich glycol flash drum consists of three compartments: the inlet settling compartment, the hydrocarbon bucket, hydrocarbon collection bucket, and the rich glycol outlet compartment. Right. So what happens is that the inlet stream, which contains rich glycol along with hydrocarbons, will be first subjected to settle in the inlet settling compartment, which has some residence time, and it allows to settle the hydrocarbons and the rich glycol. So the hydrocarbons, being the lighter phase, will move up and overflow through the baffle and gets collected inside the hydrocarbon collection bucket. And from there, it will be removed and sent to the hydrocarbon collection header. And the rich glycol, being heavier, it will move through an internal pipe, and from there it will be collected in the rich glycol outlet compartment, from where it is sent to the regeneration section. Alright, so the rich glycol, which gets collected in the rich glycol outlet compartment, will be sent to a rich glycol filter, rich glycol charcoal filter, and rich glycol filters. About 25% of the slipstream of the rich glycol will be sent to the rich glycol charcoal filter for removal of hydrocarbons. Actually, this rich glycol charcoal filter will be designed for 25% capacity, because already we have a skimming hydrocarbon removal facility. That is, at the bottom of the glycol contactor, we have a hydrocarbon skimming bucket from where you can remove and skim off some hydrocarbons, just in case if some hydrocarbons condense inside the glycol contactor. So for that reason, the glycol charcoal filter will be designed for 25% capacity, because you already have a hydrocarbon removal facility provided at the bottom of the glycol contactor. And the remaining glycol will pass through the rich glycol filters. These filters are used to remove the organic acids which might have been formed because of the degradation of glycol. Actually, when glycol gets degraded, it results in the formation of organic acids, and it is very important to remove these organic acids outside your system because it will start making your TEG corrosive. Alright, so after getting filtered, the rich glycol will be sent to the lean rich glycol heat exchanger, where it will exchange heat with the hot lean glycol coming from the glycol reboiler. So the temperature of the rich glycol will increase from 72 degrees Celsius to 155 degrees Celsius, and from there it will be routed to the middle of the glycol still above the packed section. The lean rich glycol heat exchanger is a welded plate type heat exchanger. Right. The purpose of the lean rich glycol exchanger is to economize the heat available from the lean glycol in order to reduce the glycol reboiler duty. So all the rich glycol will be heated up to 155 degrees Celsius, and it will be introduced to the middle of the glycol still, and the rich glycol will flow down and it will come in contact with the rising water vapors and stripping gas. And the rich glycol will collect at the bottom of the glycol reboiler, and it will be heated up to a temperature of 204 degrees Celsius. In that way, the bulk of water present in the rich glycol will be stripped and removed, and the hot water vapors will move up the stripper through the packed section, and it will condense in the reflux condenser, and the liquids that condense will serve as reflux to the still glycol still. In that way, it will maintain the overhead line temperature at about 92 degrees Celsius, which is important to ensure that there is no any glycol slipping on the overhead. All right. The heat provided to the reboiler is with the help of high pressure steam, and it has a de-superheater in order to control and maintain the temperature exactly at 204 degrees Celsius for maximum removal of water. However, if you increase the temperature beyond 204 degrees Celsius, it will give a better glycol purity, but that will start degrading your glycol. The degradation of glycol starts from 206 degrees Celsius, and when your glycol degrades, it will affect the properties of the glycol, and that will not give you proper results. So after heating up inside the glycol reboiler, the purity of the glycol will be at around 98.5% by weight to 99% by weight. But however, we need to increase the purity up to 99.9% by weight in order to get the required dry gas specification. For that, we introduce a stripping gas, which is nothing but your sales gas that is taken off from your sales gas header. The stripping gas will be introduced into the glycol reboiler bath, where it is heated through an internal pipe that is kept installed inside the glycol reboiler up to a temperature of about 120 degrees Celsius, and that will be introduced to the bottom of the glycol stripper, and the lean glycol will overflow from the top and enter the glycol stripper from the top, and in that way the stripping gas will strip the remaining water that is present in the glycol, and therefore it will improve the purity up to 99.9% by weight. Actually, what the stripping gas does is that the dry stripping gas will reduce the partial pressure of water in the gas phase, thereby facilitates to remove more water from the glycol during regeneration in order to improve the purity that is required for the required dry gas specification. Alright, then the lean glycol will come down at a purity of 99.9% and it will exchange heat with the rich glycol and cools down to a temperature of 102 degrees Celsius, and from there it is sent to the glycol surge drum. The glycol surge drum serves like a buffer for circulating the clean glycol to the glycol contactor. Right, the glycol surge drum will be pressure balanced with the glycol stripper, and all these equipments will be properly kept at correct elevations in order to allow gravity flow. Alright, so the reflux is very critical, especially when you're using stripping gas, because that will lead to glycol carryover on the overhead. So therefore, the temperature has to be correctly maintained on the overhead line at around 92 degrees Celsius. Alright, there's also a bypass line provided across the still condenser, just in case if the overhead line temperature goes too low, and that will result in the flooding of the glycol still. But in most cases, the temperature wall will be completely closed, and all the flow will be actually passing through the still condenser. Because of significant difference in the boiling point between water and the TEG, relatively small column, a very good separation takes place in a relatively small column. So that's the thing about it. And the lean glycol from the glycol surge drum will be pumped with the help of a reciprocating type triplex plunger type pump, and increases pressure up to 59 bar, and that is sent to the glycol contactor at 66 degrees Celsius. Right, the temperature of the lean glycol entering the glycol contactor should be correctly maintained at least 5 to 10 degrees Celsius higher than that of the inlet feed gas temperature. And this is a very critical parameter. The primary reason why the temperature of the lean glycol should be higher than the inlet feed gas temperature is because if the temperature is low, then the hydrocarbons will start condensing inside your glycol contactor, and that will lead to severe foaming problems and increased glycol losses. So this can be understood with the help of the phase envelope. Alright, so this is your phase envelope. Alright, the gas that is leaving your TEG will be at its dew point. So, alright, so this is the phase envelope. And this is your gas, which is close to your dew point curve. So when you start reducing the temperature, the gas will move into the two-phase region inside the envelope, and here the hydrocarbons will start condensing into liquid. And when that happens, you will find operating problems almost immediately. And therefore, you have to make sure that you have to keep the lean TEG temperature as low as possible, because you're going to get a very good performance in terms of your vapor-liquid equilibrium. But at the same time, you should make sure that the lean TEG temperature should always be higher than that of the inlet feed gas temperature in order to avoid any hydrocarbons from condensing into your unit. Alright, so let us discuss some of the important operating parameters for efficient running of the plant. Alright, so these are some of the key operating parameters. The first one is the lean TEG concentration. For a given dry gas specification, the lean TEG concentration is dependent upon the depression of the dew point for a given dry gas specification. That is, if your lean TEG concentration is lower than what is required, and if you are circulating more TEG, it is not going to give you the required dry gas specification. is your contactor pressure. The dehydration is especially more effective at higher pressure because the saturated water content of the gas is lower. Operating at higher pressure also minimizes the glycol entrainment losses through the dimensor because the gas velocities will be lower for the same mass flow rate. The next thing is your glycol temperature. The dehydration is especially sensitive to the temperature of the gas that is entering your glycol contactor. Hotter gas means it carries more water content. So if the temperature of the feed gas increases, it means that more water will enter your DEG contactor, and then there is a potential, there's a possibility for a potential off-spec. So therefore, you have to correctly maintain the inlet feed gas temperature within the design limit. Right, and then we have the glycol circulation rate. For a given number of theoretical trays and the lean glycol concentration, the dry gas specification, that is the dew point depression of the saturated gas, will be a function of your TEG circulation rate. So normally the circulation is maintained at around 27 meter cube per hour, but however you can go down, but if you decrease it below a certain minimum value, say about 30 meter cube per hour, that will affect your dehydration performance. So it's always recommended to maintain at the design optimum value, which is about 27 meter cube per hour. Right, and then we have the revolver temperature and stripping gas flow rate. The revolver temperature should be correctly maintained at 204 degrees Celsius in order to ensure optimum removal of water from the glycol and to give you a purity between 98.5 to 99.5% by weight. But however, if you increase the glycol temperature beyond 204 degrees Celsius, it is going to give you a better purity, but it will start degrading your glycol because the degradation of glycol starts from 206 degrees Celsius. And as I said earlier, when glycol degrades, it will result in the formation of organic acids, and the organic acids will start making your TEG corrosive. So therefore, it is not recommended to increase the temperature beyond the 204 degrees Celsius. And also, if you increase the stripping gas flow rate, it will also improve the purity of your glycol, but that will come at the expense of excessive fuel gas consumption, and it will also increase your glycol entrainment losses in the overhead. So normally, the stripping gas flow rate will be maintained within the design. This is about 200 to 250 kg per hour. Alright guys, that was all about the tech dehydration process. I hope that it was easy to understand. If you have any questions or doubts, or if you need more information, please comment down below. Stay subscribed if you're looking for such type of content. And thank you for watching the video till the end. Until then, I will see you in the next one.